My name is Berit Aas. I'm a scientist, social scientist, and also a peace and feminist activist. Today is the 31st of May. I'm sitting here in my own house in Asker in Norway, and I'm going to make some kind of reflections upon men, technology, and rationality. And I'm going to refer to a lecture which I gave in Sweden as early as in 1978-79, because the Norwegian, no, the Swedish women, they didn't want Swedes to make nuclear reactors. So there were great demonstration all over Sweden, and they did a marvelous thing which only the big firms do today. They made big flags about no to the common market, and no, that was no to nuclear energy. And they embroidered those big flags, and they put them up on the flagpoles. You could look at them all over Sweden, but you see, they didn't win. It was a strength in the patriarchy, which really almost lured them into it, because for a long time it looks like there would be no nuclear power stations in Sweden. But then suddenly the Social Democrats, they made a third alternative. And I don't remember exactly what it was, if it was that it should only come up and be there for a short time, or it was something that really made very many of the women who were positive to social democratic politics believe that it really wasn't such a big danger after all. So, in fact, this big group, Women for Peace, I think they had three or four big peace organizations. They didn't want to have nuclear power, but they were splitted up. And this is, of course, a very good master theory, to split and to win. That happened in Sweden. But during this big campaign, among the women, I went to a school, Hessinge School, to really promote and to support the women in their kind of avoid this environmental and health threat, which we knew at that time, really radiation from Hiroshima bomb was. But the thing is that while I was working with them, and also had those confrontations with lots of men in the industry, in the army, in political thinking of power, I just started to wonder, do we really have some different values? Is it that we have this female culture? I had already started to think about the possibility that it was a secret or an invisible women culture everywhere, in every nation. And if it was a different value system, could it be that we really lived in two different cultures? That it wouldn't be so difficult to understand from Marxist theory, that what was over everyday life, were over different kinds of responsibilities, the different kinds of work done, paid work, unpaid work, the different kinds of people we were working with and for, children, handicapped, old people, and or if you worked with the army or with the construction firm or just with the producing things from a kind of successive movement on a kind of a band. Could it be that it shaped our thinking? And from that position, I suddenly remembered an anthropologist in America who was very, very well known, very smart. She was at the same time of Margaret Mead, who wrote this Male and Female. She's unfortunately almost forgotten now. But Ruth Benedict, she said something about cultures. And I think perhaps to understand different kind of cognitive systems, which different kinds of intelligence, different kinds of understanding of cause and effect, we could start thinking about her because she has some ideas about cultures. The cultures, she says, consists of a series of elements. And those elements might be quite different in different cultures. And I was immediately thinking about, for instance, the Sami culture, which has seven gods, four goddesses and three male gods. They knew that snow and ice and cold weather was necessary to really slaughter the reindeer and to prepare the meat. They knew that the kind of snow they would need to really move from the inner part of their area to the islands had to be very, very stiff so that their sleds could go on them. They were very, very dependent upon this, and they were very dependent upon the fact that it was, I think it was eight different seasons. They didn't have four. They were very sensitive to weather, and not only weather, but for instance, the light. So the midnight sun, we call it, but of course, this means that it's very dark for a long, long season up there. But it isn't pitch dark. I thought that. I went up there and I got very surprised when I understood how the snow and the stars and the moon and so on made everything really visible. But this is something that is so different in, for instance, Kerala in India. Which was a place that the Norwegians were very concerned about when they were doing their support of poor countries in the south. They had never seen the midnight sun. They have never seen the long dark winter. They didn't know what snow was, and not at all what kind of value in the production process, in the life conditions of the Sami it was. While the Sami, of course, they would have very difficulties in understanding how women on the beach was waiting for those enormous different kinds of fish, which had to be conserved in very different ways. And the way the trading went between the men and the women, a series of those things that was of the utmost importance for the production and the life of the people in Kerala. So if we should think in the in the way that Ruth Benedict would look at those cultures, she would put up reindeer as a resource, climate, the history, child-rearing, clothing, making the clothes of leather or of other kinds of material. They would put up food, food conditions. They would talk about different kinds of sickness and health, religion, and the same kind of elements would be available, really, but with other contents in Kerala. And then she said there always would be one of those themes that were most important. I mean, the thing that everything really was decided by. And if you don't think exactly of the Same and the Kerala people, I think that, for instance, when you think of the Indian tribes which attributed everything to the muscus or to the bison. So she insisted that in every culture you have at a certain time, long time, short time, a kind of a central kind of issue to which you really connect most of the other things. And she went so far as I thought that she did it, but perhaps she did not. So if you drew a picture of this, you could draw lines between the themes or the items, and you would pretty soon find out that these patterns looked quite different according to what was the kind of the central or the dominant theme of that culture. And from that I suddenly started to understand her main thing, the patterns of culture, the structure of culture, which she wrote a beautiful book about. And later in our days I thought, oh, it takes a long time, but certainly in the 50s, 60s in Norway, it was very much socialism, it was planned economy. And then now in 2010 and after, it's the market, it's competition, it is fighting for the resources, it is killing your best friend if he has a firm that is similar to yours. I mean, this very different kinds of central themes is also something that that you can find in the new societies, that it shifts, but that isn't according to where they are located. It is according to how we communicate. But anyhow, I started to think, what is the major themes in the male culture? And what is the major themes if it was an invisible women culture? And in behavior science, we have also very strong leaning to the idea that in the family you grow up, it is very important in sex role training that the boys and girls, they are taken in different direction very early by playing, by the kind of language is used towards them, how in almost every country a girl should behave different from a boy, and certainly a teenage girl different from a teenage boy. So it's clothes and it's motorcycles, it's really division. And the more I thought about this, I thought, how important is technology in this issue? And this continued to take hold of my mind. So when I started to read the different sciences, and especially perhaps economy, you have some paradigms. And in economy you have this kind of utility question. which says that whatever you do, you choose what serves you best. So if you have two kinds of food in a store, you choose, and I think the idea was brought to me by an economist, said, you know, if you have a a tomato and you have onion, of course you would immediately choose the tomato because the onion would smell so badly. And I thought, God, what kind of example? But of course, he continued, and he said, you know, and you come into a store and you have you shall buy a kind of a tool, and you know that this will serve you much better than this. You pick the one that serves you best. Yeah. So the thing is, the utility of this paradigm is that you always choose what is of the most importance to you. And I thought, what do they choose who have no money? I mean, but this was, you shouldn't think so in such way, Berit thought. It's, you know, this is about choices between good and something that's still better. Utility. And I said, perhaps this is something you could use in psychology when it comes to conditioning. That the thing, and I thought of Pavlov's dog. If really things make you get lots of rewards, and another thing gives you a punishment, of course, over and over again, your mind is structured very much about the condition that supports what you can really enjoy and use. So perhaps we have some of the same thing in psychology. Perhaps we have something in anthropology too. And I started to think about that. And after a while, I heard that in Harvard, they were in the situation that they wanted to create artificial intelligence. And that this was something that was almost linear. So that if you should make a car, for instance, on those rolling bands, you would start with part one and then go to part two, part three, perhaps part four would come from another line, you put it together, and finally you had a car. Yeah. And that was some of the ideas of Tyler and the new process, that you went around with a kind of a stop clock and you said, how much time does this part production take? So how much time would this take? How much time would this take? And then to increase the production, you just had to speed up each of those small processes. And suddenly I tried really to think, how is women's production? And in my mind at that time, I had very many young women friends, and they had small kids, and I was just I had a kind of a fantasy or a picture of one of these women standing in her kitchen and re-cooking some jam because it had been a little spoiled. But she had a 2 years old girl or boy who was sitting on her potty in the bathroom. And while she was doing this cooking, she had the wash machine going. And there was a washing machine which she had to turn knobs from time to time. And not only that, but in fact, she went back and forth sewing on a little thing that she was preparing for this 2 years old. And then, while this was going on, very many, many different kinds of things at the same time, the child was saying that, come, mama, I need you now, I need you now. And at that time, the cooking was boiling over, and she should really have turned the knobs on the washing machine. And at that time, the postman was ringing the clock at the door, and he cried, come, you have to sign this, otherwise I can't give away the package. And then in the midst of all this, the phone called, and it was her mother-in-law who screamed in the telephone, I have fallen down the steps, you have to come immediately. I think I have broken my hip. Does this woman then sit down on a chair thinking, what will give me the highest reward? Which thing should I do first? Because those things weren't really existing in a row, they were happening at the same time. And in some way I felt that while this old paradigm which I've heard about said that you would choose the thing that would give you the highest reward, she was choosing from another system. She said, what catastrophe can I avoid first? And from that basic kind of avoiding, which really has at its center the kind of thinking, for what will I be punished most? She chose the way she would in some way order her activities. And this became such a idea in my head that very often when I was out in different and gave different speeches on something that always came up, men and women say, this results in this. And very often I heard women say, is that for sure? Might it have some other results? And of course, everybody knows about unforeseen results and consequences. But that, which would be very, very kind of in the forefront of women because of their kind of conditions, because they can't really choose very much. I mean, you are a bad girl, you're a bad woman if you don't take care of a mother-in-law, if you don't take nicely care of your kid, if you do not think all the times about caring and supporting and in some way being nice to people, and if you are that, if you are selfish and so on, then you are really not a good woman. While a man, it seems to me that this production and this very fast production and do one thing at a time. And very often people laugh when I say, have you had a husband who has told you that you must do one thing at a time? And they laugh. And I say, yes, we have heard it. And not only that, but I said, how should I get everything done if I didn't have many things going on at the same time? And it really has come to some kind of test when I let all the household things and the caretaking and so on being taken over by a man who in some way thinks that I have nothing to do, so he should paint the wall and he should fix the garden and so on because he had a whole day. And then you come back and the wall isn't painted because the baby was crying and he had to make a new shift on it. And not only that, but there was wind and rain coming, so he had to take in the clothes from the lions, and he never had done that before. And suddenly some people called him on the phone, and that was while he was taking care of the baby. So he had to make them wait and to call back. So he had no time to make that painting. So much for one thing at a time. And it really struck me that this must have something to do with the construction of our rationality. That in some way, this doing one time, one thing at a time, and to do it in successive order, and to do it faster and faster, that would make for some kind of production which would give high rewards in higher money return. So that this idea about that everything is in a way happening in a straight line, that this could be a thinking or a way of drawing conclusions which came from one kind of life, while women and also farmers, I thought. Farmers in the field, they can't really say to the corn, grow faster. And they can't tell the cows to milk faster. Or you should grow faster, you know, to small animals which you want to sell on the market for food. Grow faster. Now, with the new chemistry, of course. This wasn't there in the 70s. That's what they do. And you really can question how much health that gives to our salmons if they are polluted, to the big Netherland cow. In 1960s, in the end, this wasn't anything we knew about. The interesting thing about this is that if you really have such a different kind of value system and such a different kind of understanding of what's the cause and what is the effect, and if this in some way also includes what effects will this give in the long time? A child takes 16, 18 years before you let him or her out of your house. What would happen to him or her if your kind of child rearing is either this, methodologically, technological, give the child a breast every fourth time, being this kind of mechanical in your thinking, which we know, all mothers know that they have been under that kind of regime, the doctor's regime, how things should be done, almost mechanically, and how you felt that this was wrong. And of course it came a new ideology about how the child should decide how you took care of it. And that for certainly took all the women's attention and really didn't give her a pause of 3 hours between each feeding. A mother had, as an English psychologist said, motherhood is 365 days a year, and it is 24 hours a day. That should be the kind of the good mother's kind of ideal. So you wonder, the worker who stands in the industry and has to do things faster and faster to compete for his firm. So he takes over other neighbors' firms and earns much money, and not only on the local scene but on the national scene, and not now only on the national scene but on the international and global scene. But anyhow, this kind of linking the understanding of your surroundings, of the world around you, wouldn't that be influenced by the way, in some way, your daily life have forced you to behave? We have a psychologist, Melvin Kahn, who has done some of this among industrial workers and the middle class. I think he has done it both in Italy and America, and where he says that in some way the working class men have been educated in such a way that they obey, why the upper class or the capitalist class or the entrepreneurs are not told to obey but to think differently, to in some way be in opposition, to find new ways of doing. And this is quite important research, and if this is done between workers and those who have capital and own the machinery, why couldn't you use such a thinking between those who do the unpaid, caring work and the male society, where almost everywhere you're talking about having a job, earning money, as much money as possible. And it's very interesting. Every day I come across such kind of different thinking. For instance, I have a daily called Klassekampen. And today it is a young man who said, it is very wrong to ask for more free time instead of more money. And I immediately said, What's wrong about that if you really have enough? And then I thought further about all those who have no works to go to, who have so much free time. Why shouldn't you take a little less time away from your work and perhaps give that work to those who have no work but much time? So this kind of not only thinking in increasing your kind of profit, increasing your salary. If you only have this kind of limited understanding of your own life and what I need, and you don't see that for some people, freedom is not a gift, but is something that they have been thrown into, this kind of absolutely free time, because you have no choice. Why don't give away a little of your occupied time to those who have so much time? That would be a good idea. I mean, all over the world now you have people who are just stressed, they're completely outworked, and they have to go to psychiatrists and so on. And you have this growing group of young people without work. Why couldn't they give away a third or a fifth of their work time and make workplaces for those who have so much free time that they can't exist because they have no earnings? And so you get all these kind of ideas when you start thinking about those different cultures and who are in some way experiencing the wonderful thing about the free time. Artists, painters, writers, because they have a control over their free time, and they have both free time and they have something which they can sell. And then in Norway we have a big conflict today between teachers, because they are told to be doing things after the clock and write down exactly what they did. That is exactly not the teachers, but the schemes which they have to fill in. And in fact, their pupils are only as if they are nails or small screws, which should be screwed so much, so much. And have you been lucky in getting it really screwed in, you teacher? Report on this scheme. And this is not how people learn either. You have to have in some, you have to have time to reflect, but not only that, you have also to have some kind of pressure. If you don't have some kind of expectations thrown towards you, it's very hard to really push yourself forward. So it is a blending of these two kind of cultures that would perhaps be not the most productive for profit, but would possibly be the most good one for developing some kind of rewards and good living for everywhere. But these, in these latest years, I think they have gone completely crazy. That system which really are the production for profit and for fighting and for war and for weapon and for infrastructure and for data. While that welfare system, it is a threat to it everywhere. And in my country, very much of the welfare system are not paid at all. Or the money that was allocated for those welfare systems seems slowly to break down, as they have in America. It's happened here in Norway and Sweden. You should get more health for the crown, more health for the cent, more health for the mark. So this is a way of thinking, and I have elaborated on this a meeting in Sweden in 1968, and I think I made it perhaps a little more clear or structured because it became a radio program, and from radio program. We had a big car industry in Sweden which made Volvo. It's a name of a car. And the vice director there, he called me and he said, "Oh, I always thought that it was only one kind of intelligence, one kind of rationality, and that it was in the way you describe as a kind of a linear thing. And I know that over at Harvard University in USA, they are developing now artificial intelligence. But you are right, I don't think it's only one intelligence. I think it's a difficult kind of understanding cause and effect. So would you please take a trip over to Harvard and find out how they are working?" And he sent me over. Or he gave me money to travel over. And when I came to Harvard, they had already left the idea that it was this one-dimensional linear kind of intelligence. But they still are making those robots, of course, and I'm very curious about how this really is done, what kind of models they have, if they all stem from those male technology students in chemistry and physics, or if they really take more of the humanities, more of the values, more of the threats for difficulties and for harm on people and animal and environment, if that is goes into their heads when they are composing this kind of artificial intelligence.